All right, here we are back again with another version of Word on the Street. Thanks so much for joining us once again. And today we have Wayne C. Blue and her trouble fakers. Well, we have one of them anyway. We have Ron with us today. But before we get to that, I have actually a whole bunch of stuff to mention. And I'm not going to mention it all at the top on this intro. This intro will be roughly 10 minutes. So if you're not the intro type, you don't like intros, skip ahead 10 minutes and you can get into the conversation with Wayne C. Blue. Otherwise, stick around for a moment. I want to tell you a few things. And what I don't tell you here on the intro, I'm going to tell you at the outro. So the outro will be long as well, which it usually always is. But anyways, the first thing, super important, super awesome, super amazing thing, the podcast got its first Patreon donor. And I'm super, super excited for that. So thank you, Sarah. And the way I'm going to run it, every time I get a Patreon donor, I'm going to shout out them the week after they donate. And I'm just going to do first names for now. I'm not going to do last names. So it'll keep it somewhat anonymous if you don't want to be mentioned on air fully. But you'll know who you are because you'll go, hey, my name is Sarah and I donated last week. That must be me. So anyways, Sarah is our first donor, so and she's donating $1 a month to the podcast, which, hey, you got to start somewhere, right? So thank you so much, Sarah, for supporting local independent music, for wanting to know more of what's going on in the Seattle and Northwest music scene. You make it happen. So the only thing now is we need Sarah to get some friends over there on Patreon. So hopefully you will be able to become a friend of Sarah by also donating to the podcast. I wanted to mention one little thing real quick before we get too deep. Just, I wanted to bring up this idea of politics. So as we know, and this is, as you know, this is not a political podcast, and it will never be. However, we are embroiled in kind of a heated state right now of national politics. There's a lot of people that are really excited about what's been going on with our new president and policies that are starting to happen and all these different things that are going on. And I wanted to just encourage you to take a moment to basically breathe instead of getting caught up in what's going on politically. Because I've seen a lot, you know, Facebook notorious for false politics, you know, people just posting things they believe, not what's the reality. So what I want to encourage you to do, if you are one that's confused or just wants to learn more about what's going on or different things like that, I've made a commitment to myself coming up from here on out to learn more about what is actually going on with politics. And I'm going to once a week consume some form of political journalism in some way or another. And the one I'm starting with is a podcast. So if you like podcasts, which I hope you do because you're listening to one right now, there's a podcast called Congressional Dish. And I encourage you to check it out and, you know, and see if it fits with what you want to learn about politics. And I also encourage you not to seek out voices that agree with you. I encourage you to seek out voices that may have a different opinion of you, and hopefully voices that are well spoken and can talk about why they have their opinion and give you valid reasons and are not just, you know, using tactics and fear and different things like that to try to convince you of an idea, but are actually using sound logic and reason to convince you of ideas. And I believe the curator of Congressional Dish, I don't have her name in front of me right now, but I believe she does use sound logic and reason when she's talking about the ideas. She does thorough research and she's fun to listen to. So I encourage you to check out Congressional Dish. I'll link it up in the description of this podcast. It'll be at the bottom of the description of the podcast. So go do that. And one other little quick nugget on the idea of politics is basically just that I think there's two types of people in the world. There's people that only think of themselves, and there's people that only think of others, basically, if you look at a spectrum, and people fall within that spectrum. They're either on one side of the spectrum or the other. And I don't believe either end of that spectrum is healthy. You do not, you should not only think of yourselves and you should not only think of others. However, when it comes to my personal belief in what is better for the world, if you go to that 50% mark and you go one notch toward thinking of others, I think that 51% toward thinking of others over thinking of yourself, and how ideas and how actions and how thoughts and how policies and how things affect others more than it affects yourself, is a positive way to consider how you consume and how you react to the world. And that's just my personal belief, because I am definitely, I feel like I'm way farther to the thinking of others before myself spectrum, and I don't think it's always healthy for me. So I'm actually trying to slide into how can I think of myself and make sure I'm doing the right things for myself before I think of others. But that's just me. So I believe if you take that spectrum and divide it in half and just go one notch toward, how are my actions, what am I doing actually helping the world survive better, the society I'm involved with grow and thrive and become a better society. And I think the way to accomplish that is to think of others a little bit more than you think of yourself. So consider that. You don't have to agree with me. I don't care if you agree with me. That's just my idea. And maybe you'll think about it. That would be awesome. Because the bottom line with this whole political thing, I'm at the point where I'm just letting the world, I'm trying to find people that can speak on the ideas for me right now. I'm looking for people that think that I agree with and can speak on the world for me, because I personally cannot speak on politics. I do not know enough about politics to speak on it. What I do know is local music, is the Seattle music scene, and that's where I've decided to invest my energy, and that's where I want to keep my energy invested. And if you want to also invest some energy and time and commitment to the local music scene, there's three awesome ways to do it. The first way is to go to iTunes. Yes, I said iTunes. It's the big gun when it comes to podcasts. It's where all things podcasts happen. If you want to have a successful podcast, the quickest way to create it is to get some action over on iTunes. So having your help do that would be awesome. And if you go to iTunes, subscribe to the podcast, and then rate and review it, that'd be sweet. And there's you can go to WOTSpodcast.com and find the link to it, or search Word on the Street and look for the logo with two robots. Give me a review. I haven't had a review for a really long time. I really like that to happen. So I need you to go do that for me. That'd be awesome. Another great way to support the podcast is that Patreon, like I mentioned on top, basically monetary donations. I'm looking for more monetary donations for the podcast. So you can do it through Patreon, patreon.com/thezim, T-H-E-Z-I-M, or you can go to WOTSpodcast.com. There's the Patreon button there, and also a PayPal button where you can do a one-time donation. The Patreon's good for monthly donations if you want to set up a regular thing. The PayPal button's good for a one-time. I just want to give them $25 and be done with it. Give the podcast, I should say, $25 and be done with it. That's it. That's how you do it. The third great way to support the podcast is to go to facebook.com/WordOnTheStreetPodcast and give that page a like. At this moment of recording this intro, we are 9 likes away from 1,000 likes, and that's awesome. So I need you to go support the podcast by liking the page, sharing it with your friends, telling your friends about the podcast, because we need to grow this thing. We need to get more people aware of it. As of right now, as well, we've had the podcast all inclusive has reached 5,004 downloads, which sounds kind of good, but if you divide it by the amount, 118 or 19, you know, items have been published so far. I had this one intro for the podcast. I don't count as a full podcast, but anyway, that's up there too. If you divide it by all those, you know, episodes, essentially, it means each one has been downloaded 42 times, and that's not nearly good enough. We need to get each episode up into the hundreds, if not thousands, of downloads, and that really takes you to do that for me. You have to share. You have to tell your friends. You have to create this culture, this environment, this idea that we want more people to know about what's going on in the Seattle music scene. All right, and Northwest, of course. So let's get on with this podcast. Like I said at the top, we got Wincy Blue and Her Trouble Faker this time. Normally, there would be an S on the end of that, but we got Ron joined us as well. of the Trouble Fakers. So let's do this. Main thing is recording. We are recording. Once again, back with the word on the street with Wynn and Ron. We're going to learn all about Wynn and Ron. Wynn, you have to tell me, why don't you go ahead and say your full name for us?
Well, on stage, I go by Wynn C. Blue. That's Wynn, middle initial C. Blue, like the color. Mm-hmm. And we are billed when we're in a band as Wynn C. Blue and her Trouble Fakers. And there's an evolution.
Trouble Fakers?
Trouble Fakers, yeah. Not Troublemakers. Cool. That's just too easy to... Everybody's a troublemaker. Don't give me that.
Yeah. So, especially you guys.
we just pretend to be rabble rousers and misfits. We're not actually troublemakers.
How old is the Trouble Fakers name?
It goes back to the founding of the band when it was just the Trouble Fakers. I came across
this is Ron, by the way.
Yeah, this is my associate and chief Trouble Faker, Ron Allen.
Hi, Ron.
Hey,
chief Trouble Faker.
Yeah, we've been collaborating on releases since, was it 2009?
I have a 2008 folder on my computer.
2008? So. Oh, okay. That's awesome. You're right there with me and A-Rock. We've been going since 2009. So you have a year on us.
Okay.
So, that's awesome.
The Trouble Fakers go all the way back to 2005.
Well, then you buried us.
Well, in what?
It's not a contest.
It's totally not a contest. Oh. We've been
okay,
kind of just slogging along.
I wasn't sure. Now it's cleared up. Okay, good.
Now, the original name came from a long process of the original members of the Trouble Fakers, Ethan, Ed, and Laurel. We all got together and we were trying to figure out some musical outlet, because Ethan is Ethan Freckleton. He's a soloist in the scene. He recently decided to go a different direction entirely, and we wish him the best. But he and I were chief collaborators and songwriters for a long time, and we needed a band name. And so we had this big long list of video game inspired names and James Bond inspired names, and the Trouble Fakers came along from an old story I told back from when I was in marching band.
Awesome.
I was a band geek.
We have to get into that story.
We will.
Because I'm a band geek too.
Yeah, what'd you play?
Saxophone.
I was not that cool. I played French horn.
Okay.
I played French horn, and I was never, ever more than last chair.
Did you play, what's the marching version of French horn?
Mellophone?
Is that it? Mm-hmm. It's kind of like this really big trumpet looking thing.
It is. It's like a trumpet with a really big bell on
it. Yeah. Did you ever play that?
I did play that. Actually, it's the only French horn type instrument that I actually still own.
Oh, okay.
And but for the first year of marching band, I actually was out there on the field in my really uncomfortable hat and wool outfit.
Super tall pants.
Super tall pants, nice. And shoes that had to be white no matter what. Holding that damn curly French horn up in front of me. I had really strong shoulders for a very long time.
You're doing what I like to typically do at the top of a podcast. You're kind of doing it already, which is I do like a bullet point rundown of ideas that we could get into. So we've already brought up the Trouble Fakers. Mm-hmm. That is definitely going to be a heavy, probably part of the conversation. We'll learn all about you just showed me you have two albums you already have out, and you have one you're working on, it sounds like, so we can get into that. You just mentioned your French horn, band geekness, which is awesome, and that tip, you know, we can get into that. We'll see where the conversation goes. One thing I know as well that you're involved with, which is actually the one of the main catalysts for being inspired to, you know, connect with you and go, let's do this, is you are also not only a musician but an illustrator.
Yes, I am.
And so, and
yeah,
I love
super awesome illustrator.
I know. That's yeah. You know, and I love, so for me, and one of the big parts of Word on the Street is like discovering that we're more than just musicians. It's like what other things we do, and like that really inspired me to go like, wow, she's a musician, she's active in the scene, she's playing shows, and she's
this awesome illustrator. So I was like,
yeah,
like,
that's where, you know, fine arts is one of my primary background. I mean, as a kid and as a high school student, I did have a background in music. My father played guitar for all my life. And so I had that background. I've always sung in some way.
Yeah.
But my first passion was always drawing and illustration. And I went to college and got my fine arts degree. So my fine arts degree was in photography and graphic design.
Nice. Yeah.
I didn't, you know, do the Seattle Art Institute. No, I went. Yeah. I had to go to a university and spend copious amounts of
high
money.
High fives!
And,
I did too. Woo. I'm a fine art major as well.
I know you do. You work in textiles, right?
Yes, totally.
Which is totally awesome. High five!
Yes, let's do it. I love high fives. Okay. Could you hear that? So, Ron, we're definitely going to need to hear from you as well in this.
I will speak. Yeah, fully functioning voice box.
But is there anything else? That maybe something that maybe you've been thinking of that you want to bring up during this conversation at all? Because you don't have to. No pressure.
Ron's a producer, actually. This is his studio. We're actually recording this in his studio.
Exactly. It doesn't look like a studio. It looks like a basement cleverly disguised as a studio.
Have you been to many studios, Ron? A lot of places. The only thing you're missing is
a giant... There's no piss on the carpet or anything like that. So.
Yeah, that's true.
This is an awesome space. I walked in here, so I like to set up the theater of the mind, right?
Yeah.
And when I walked in here, I was like, wow, this is awesome. The ambiance of we got the fireplace going, you got this nice L-shaped couch that we're sitting on, and in the corner, you got the main command center with the speakers and the mixing board and all that good stuff, which is gets me excited. And then what got me super excited was we have Ron's son was gifted not just a Star Destroyer, but a Super Star Destroyer.
The Super Star Destroyer Lego. I think it's about 4,000 Legos. It's insane, and they're all super tiny.
You had to put it together to avoid stepping on it.
Yeah, totally.
So that is very...
It's about 4 feet long.
Exactly. Legos, this is not the first time Legos have come up on We're on the Street
podcast. It's probably probably a theme.
Yeah,
so you can play air guitar with that thing as well. Yeah. Just FYI.
So awesome. So that's good. So we set up some bullet points of things we may get into. We set up the theater of the mind. So what I want to do is just, I've kind of changed my format a little bit.
Okay.
I used to be a lot more freeform, and I just started asking particular questions to each of my guests. So I'm going to ask you guys 4 questions. I'm adding, it used to be 3. Now I'm adding a 4th question.
Ooh, experimental.
We're gonna go around in here, and I want to get your answers to these questions. And let me say the questions first, so you can think about them, and then we'll do them one at a time. So the first question is, why do you play music? Like, what is it about music that you like, or whatever it is? Why do you do it? And then the second question is, who in your musical journey has been your greatest support? You know. Whatever that may be, interpret it however you like. The third question is, if there's one thing that you could just, like a wish or just like something that you've been like, if this could just happen, or if I wish I could do this, what is the one thing that you want for your journey as a musician? And then the 4th question is a little bit more, I think, open, but it's just, what does it mean to you to be, when I say, the Seattle music scene or Northwest music scene, what comes to mind when you hear that idea? Like, what is it? Could be whatever. I mean, I might play along to help you out as well. But Wynn, why don't we start with you with that first question? Is why do you make music?
I mean, the easy answer is I feel like I have to. It's been something that I have wanted to do all my life. Mm-hmm. I was a late bloomer. I didn't actually get started seriously making music until well into my 30s. Mm. And once I started and I started performing more regularly, I realized that there was more to it than just, hey, I got up on stage and this is my bucket list thing. I can check it off and then stop. No, it's a process. And I don't think I'll ever actually reach whatever goal I've superimposed over this whole process. But I would like to do one of 3 things. One is I would like to at least have one tour under my belt. I mean, I've gotten a little bit out of Seattle, which is great, but I would like to be able to go to a lot of different places and experience those things. I make music primarily because I'm driven to. There's still a lot of things that I can't express just through illustration. And sometimes when I have something that I need to work through, putting it to music is actually kind of therapy. Mm-hmm. And I don't think there's any musician on the planet that would say that it isn't.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You make music because it's a way of getting it out. It's an exercise in self-preservation, not just expression, but self-preservation.
Mm-hmm.
I remember somebody once telling me, well, I complain because if I didn't, my head would explode.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, I make music because if I didn't, my head would explode. I would have too many things digesting in there, and it needs to come out in some way, whether it's through some angry lyrics or powerful vocal or just some sort of jumping around to whatever it is, whatever tune's going on in my head. I have to. It's a self-preservation thing.
Yeah, I love that. And that's something that I'm working on for myself as well. But I encourage, especially when I hear my musician friends have complaints, you know, private conversations with me, they're complaining about things or whatever. I'm like, that's fuel for a song.
Use it. Yeah.
Use that. You know, what is going on with you? And who cares if you've already written it once before? Just write it again. You know, it's like, because those are the themes, especially, I don't know, I feel like those kind of themes are universal themes, you know, and people like to, they like to feel like they're connecting to the music that you're making. And if you can talk in universal ways, and having struggles is a universal thing. So it may relate more than you think. You may think that it's like super private or something, when it turns out it's like actually a lot of people are dealing with the same thing.
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the common things that pops up in rehearsal, and Ron will attest to this, that if I go on a complaining jag, somebody will inevitably say, I think there's a song in there, Wynn.
Yeah.
Right?
Like, we can get you to stop writing lyrics, actually. Yeah. It's almost hard not to.
Awesome. Well, Ron, tell me, why do you make music?
Well, I'm going to go back just a little bit on something you said.
Yeah, do that.
Because one thing I've noticed about bands, and just in the bands that I'm in,
mm-hmm.
is that bands aren't super passionate about their own music. They don't really show it that much. I mean, I feel that way. Like, I love the music that I play. But the one thing I noticed about both like I'm in a couple of bands and in this band especially, is when we find a cover song that we like, that we all relate to, we seem to play it with a lot more passion than we do our own stuff sometimes, because it's like a connection point. And maybe not, it's not something we created together, but it's something we can all relate to. But have you ever noticed that in bands, how like the cover songs seem to be... when you grab a cover song and you own it, like you love it more than some of your own songs. And it becomes one of your own songs.
I think we've had a couple of covers that we've done that are like that. Most notably, we have a cover song on album number... Is it number two? Yes, album number two. It's a PJ Harvey cover of Sheila na Gig.
Yeah.
I think about that often, like the whole concept of cover and why people like it externally, and why, like you're describing, like as a band. And I think part of it maybe is just because you can jump past the work and get to the fun.
Get to the nitty-gritty.
That's a lot to do with it.
Meat and potatoes, yeah.
Because it's like everybody knows it already. They've heard it. And so they know what it's supposed to sound like. And then you make your own twist on it. But it's not like you're creating it, you know?
Oh, well, that too. Well, in the case of the Sheila na Gig cover that we did, I had never heard this song before. But Ron was really adamant.
I'm a huge PJ Harvey fan.
He loves PJ Harvey. Yeah. And he played the song for me. And I didn't think too much about it. I had only ever heard a couple of PJ Harvey songs. And
Donnie was not, our drummer Donnie was not sold on it either.
Donnie was like, yeah, I don't think so, man. But once I was given, you know, I'm never going to play a cover exactly the way the original artist did it. I just don't think that that's fair.
Mm.
If I wanted to be in a cover band, I'd be in a cover band, and I would use my excellent mimic skills to be in a cover band, but I'm not. I'm Wynn C. Blue. I do my own thing. And the PJ Harvey cover was one where if you listen to them, both songs back to back, there are two distinct voices coming from that song.
Yeah. There are two different interpretations of that song.
Very much so. One is a lot angrier.
That's yours.
That's mine. Mine's definitely angrier.
Awesome. Yeah, my technique for learning a cover is I learn it just enough I never learn it verbatim so much.
That you get the feel for it, right?
I just get the feel of it. Yeah. I get it kind of in my system, and then I just stop like trying to reference the original and just kind of like make it my own. Always lyrics are different. So I've had people jump up on stage with me and try to sing. Like I'll start one. I only have a handful of covers, and they'll jump up on stage and start singing. I'm like, I'm not going to be singing the lyrics that you're going to be singing.
One of us is going to be surprised.
Yeah. Yes. Like, there's just little twists or little things, but it's generally the right thing. But
so I got into music late, but I've always been a musical person, and I always just wanted to be in a band. Okay. I love watching concert footage.
Yeah.
Like Stop Making Sense is one of my favorite movies, and I like watching band performances where you just feel like this is a great performance. And I always wanted to be just part of a band performing, but I didn't start playing guitar until I was in my mid-20s. And I used to be an artist too, when I used to draw and be an illustrator.
I remember that. I remember you
and
telling
I just,
me that.
Yeah, I just put my pencil down and started learning guitar. I haven't drawn since I started playing guitar.
Wait, you did a self-portrait for the first album, remember?
I did, yes.
Yeah, because instead of taking pictures, because I hate having my picture taken.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, sorry, fair warning. But I asked everybody to do a self-portrait. You know, like a little black and white ink drawing. And Ron's looks expert, you know, very stylized. It looks very much like him. Ed had his girlfriend draw him in pencil. I had my own little illustration. And then Donnie's looks like a mugshot.
I don't even understand Donnie's. But it looks
He used to be a police officer.
Okay.
It does look like a sketch artist
drawing. It looks like a sketch artist shot. So I actually do have the illustration with me. I'll show it to you later. Okay. But it's very fascinating that all of us have some sort of connection to visual art.
Yeah, so music doesn't pour out of me like other people. I don't feel driven to do music.
Okay.
I just love doing it, and it's just super fun to hang out with musicians and play music, and that's why I do it, I think, and why I got started.
So we learned that you're the guitar player in the band.
But he actually, if there is a chord progression that is missing a B or
F sharp minor,
or an F sharp minor, or a seventh, or a fifth, Ron's your man, because I can't play any of those things.
Okay.
I know like a whole seven chords, and two of them are A.
Yeah.
You didn't play guitar in the band for years.
No, I didn't.
So it was just me out there, like, what?
You just find the right, this is my trick on it, you find the notes that matter and kind of mute the rest. But see, I'm not worried about dissonance either when I play guitar. A lot of my songs have open strings that shouldn't be open, and
ringing
like, all the strings all the time.
Yeah, and so I just kind of like, you know, and I don't know. I think it gives my personal sound like kind of a unique sound, but we're not talking about me. So, but that's awesome. So and then you kind of jumped to the goals thing, but we'll get back to that. But we'll get back to that again, because I want to ask you a question based on what you said earlier. But the second kind of idea is just like, what in your process, Ron, since you are new to music, like maybe yours is even more, you can maybe remember.
It's rudimentary,
Like in terms of support, like deciding to do that you said around 20?
About 25,
25, you decided to pick up, like, there must have been some kind of...
There was an impetus. So I was working at a tech company in Seattle. I'd moved up from Utah to Seattle, and it was the early 90s. And I worked with this crazy cat named Joe Weller.
Okay.
And he was a bass player in a band called Scooty Brown back in the early 90s. And that's back when bands had names like Date Rape and The Hungry Crocodiles and just, you know, crazy band names. The early Seattle scene was super awesome. It's that there was like the top tier Seattle scene, then there was the second tier Seattle scene, and then there were all the bands that I knew back then.
Yeah.
And they had a community, like there's a community now of bands that are trying to move up to those tiers, you know, to play bigger clubs or get noticed or even get on the radio or whatever.
Definitely. Tiers. Definitely. There are definitely tiers.
Yep. Absolutely. Yeah. And so I worked with this guy named Joe, and we were both working in tech, and I found out that we were doing aerospace stuff, and I found out that he played bass, and he just kept on me. Like I said, I want to learn how to play guitar, and he's like, dude, buy a guitar. So we went and bought a cheap, like $125 guitar, and I just started playing. And for the whole first year, I just practiced every day for 3 hours, and my fingers were killing me. And I, you know, when you do that, you take off.
Yeah.
Like, do you remember when you first started playing guitar? You thought, how do people do that? That's impossible. And after about a year, you think, oh, I'm playing three chords, and I'm not looking at my hand anymore. And then it just takes off from there. But yeah, so Joe got me started.
Okay, I was wondering.
So was would you say, like, in the relationship to the question of what was your biggest support, was he, Joe, your...
Joe was my initial support, so he was like the launching pad for me to get into music. And then another dude in his band named named Dave Hillman, he's actually a singer-songwriter, I think he's still around here. He inspired me to learn to be better at guitar. He'd only been playing for 10 years, and he just raged on the guitar. I just wanted to play like him, man. And I wanted, and when he let me play his guitar sometimes when I would go hang out, it was just the coolest thing ever, because he was just, you know, he was super cool. He was beautiful Dave, like, it's what I used to call him. Beautiful
Dave. Oh, jeez.
I've thought about the guitar in particular, like, how long does it take to get to a level that feels like you've been playing forever? And I feel like it's 3 years. If you're devoted for 3 years, at that point, you can make anybody think that you've been playing forever, because you've, I don't know, the experience or something. I don't know. That's just a tangent. But
a lot of it is attitude. Yeah. It's serious attitude. I remember that from way back in the day. My very first band was in college, and I remember I only knew maybe two or three chords at that point in time. And I remember watching my guitar player and thinking, how do you do that? And he's like, it's attitude. Yeah, nobody cares if you're making mistakes. You just gotta know. You gotta look like you own it.
Yeah.
Make a face. Mm-hmm. Put your feet out. Just do it.
And exactly. I don't know if it was a mistake when I started playing, but other people learned songs. I never learned songs when I was playing. So you can get good really fast in a small box of stuff if you learn a bunch of songs and you know, you can get great at that. I tried to boil the ocean on the guitar. I was like, oh, I want to play chords. I want to do la, 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 you know, and I want to, you know, just try to do everything all at once. And if you do that for like 20 years, you eventually are average at everything, which I am. And then, there you go.
You're not average at everything.
Kind of am. And so yeah, I don't know. It took me probably, like, to be able to play the guitar and sing, took me about 7 or 8 years of playing to get that kind of coordination.
Was that a major goal, was to play and sing? Because that's, for me on guitar, that was the goal. Play guitar and sing.
It took a long time. That wasn't necessarily my goal, but I loved the violin femmes, and I was always trying to learn violin femme songs, and I couldn't sing and play them at the same time until about 7 or 8 years or something like that until I got that whole... you started playing and singing at the same time.
That's deceptive. You might think that, but in reality, I bought my first guitar probably when I was about 18, and then after that I learned most of my guitar technique using a don't tell anybody this but I learned using a computer.
What?
I did. So I learned that, and by also downloading tabs from the internet, and I learned the entire library of Better Than Ezra songs.
Okay.
Because what can I say? He's in my range. It was really easy. I was listening to all that stuff constantly anyway. And so I just learned guitar like that, and then I put it down. Because I wasn't as good as the people that I was
By the way, it's been about 8 months since you recommended we play another Better Than Ezra song. Do you have another one waiting for us to try to learn
how
to play?
No, not yet. Not yet. You guys always cringe when I bring it up. So, but we have yet to actually do that. They placate me and we move on. But I was actually singing.
We'll totally learn this song. Yeah, we'll totally
learn it. I was singing and playing. I was singing and playing before I started singing and playing this year. And I actually had put the guitar down for a while to focus on being the front man, on songwriting and melody making, letting Ron and the rest of the band do most of the heavy lifting with, you know, composing and arranging, making sure that we had all that stuff together. And as my guitar stuff started to pick up, then I would contribute more, but still the band was doing most of the heavy lifting. Mm-hmm. And last year, 2015, Ron broke his hand doing something crazy.
About a year ago, I broke two bones in my
we
my
had
fretting
to
hand.
In his fretting hand. So it's not like he could have grabbed a stick and just done something like anybody would do that. But
I would.
We gotta learn slide, open tuning slide.
I would have been taping picks to my cast and just going like this or something.
Yes, but that in itself, we had to pretty much put everything on hold as far as the whole band goes, because I didn't know enough guitar.
Yeah, yeah.
But it forced me to step up my guitar game. And in October of 2015, I was invited to play my very first solo gig at Georgetown Music.
Yeah, yeah.
The acoustic Armageddon that T-Bossa does.
Yeah, yeah.
And I did that, and I was the most nervous I had ever been. I didn't know I could learn. am I going to be able to fill up 20 minutes, 30 minutes of music that I actually wrote? I had to learn the songs that Ron had put together initially, and I had to figure out, you know, how am I going to sing this? And I was super nervous, and I was cracking jokes between songs, and everybody thought it was totally natural. And I'm just kind of, yay.
Well, I love talking about, I mean, that's one of my favorite things is to talk about, like, nervous energy.
Like,
how'd you get through it, basically? Like, what was it? What was going through your mind?
Humor is the biggest thing. I will crack jokes until you know, the threat has gone away.
So you can do it on demand. You can tell jokes on demand.
Good? Well, not on. You can't point at me and say, "Here, win, crack a joke." No, I pretty much have to be in a really weird place, and then it just kind of pops out.
Yeah, I'm like that too. Like, it has to just, it just happens, and it's like. But if I'm like put on the spot to if I try to make it happen, it won't happen. But if I'm just natural and it's like
you have to let it roll. I did a number of solo-ish type gigs for what was it, 2 or 3 months.
Yeah, you did every single possible configuration of our band too.
Yeah, until Ron was back, until you were back up on your fingertips, as it were.
I think that's probably where I became more aware of you.
Yeah.
In general.
I came to your open mic at the substation. I was trying very hard to be able to put myself on stage without the support of my band. Uh-huh. And I didn't realize until I started doing solo type performances how much I depended on them as kind of, you know, the witty banter that Ron and I will exchange on stage sometimes.
And then you look over, I'm not there. And then a little tear goes down your cheek.
Yes. That's exactly what happened. I remember looking off to the side and trying to see if there was somebody I knew in the audience. And every person that I actually knew in the audience was looking at me like, and?
I actually went to some of your shows, and I was in the audience at that time. And your hands are twitching. You're like, I really do want to play on this song so much, but I can't.
Yeah, I felt for you, man. I really did. But you were broken, literally.
I hate that this is the perfect segue to a song that we might play later. But
well, we're getting close. Well, why don't we do that?
Since you
brought it up,
the first thing that I recorded after I got my splint off, the first thing that I recorded was the guitar solo on Confessions.
Ooh, Confessions. All right, yeah. Well,
so you recorded a guitar solo on Confessions. Tell us more about Confessions.
I think that probably Ron could tell us more about Confessions, simply because every February there is a musical challenge online called the RPM Challenge. And the challenge is 30 minutes of music tracks.
To write and record in that month 10 tracks or 30 minutes of music.
Yep. And you do it between February 1st and whatever the last day of February is that year.
And luckily last year I got an extra day.
Yeah, awesome. You did.
Did you need it?
Yes.
Awesome. So basically you don't start conceptualizing or writing or recording any of it until the 1st of February. Yeah, and Ron has participated in this for, is it
this
4 years?
Three times now.
Three times? Okay, so 2017 will be year number 4. And Confessions was part of a, was it 2014?
It's the very first one that I did.
So it was the first one. And so when I heard him play it for his RPM challenge, he was doing the vocal. And I listened to it and I said, you know, there's probably another verse in there you could add. And he says, oh yeah? And I went, yeah. And so what happened was I would sing and Ron went, you know what? We should just record this as a Troublefakers song. Mm-hmm. Yep. And so the track that you're about to play is the version that we perform as the Troublefakers with me in the lead vocal and adding the verse that I wrote to add on to that.
Third verse. Mm-hmm. Yep. Or the second, actually, is it the middle verse and then the last verse?
I think it's
verse?
The middle one, yeah.
So is it on one of the albums?
No, this is a single that should be out by the beginning of 2017.
Okay. All right. That puts a date on this will come
out. And we are definitely going to put it on Bandcamp. So if you follow us on Facebook, we'll announce it on Twitter. And I will probably put a link up on Instagram too, but winseyblue.bandcamp.com will put Confessions up there.
All right, so let's take a listen to Confessions by Wincy Blue and the Troublefakers.
If you're telling me that you've always had a secret life, and there is something in your past keeping you up at night. You've been dying to tell, you've been timing it right, for just the right person on just the right night. Confessions of a dangerous kind. Confessions of a dangerous time. The secret you keep has been building inside, like a monster in the basement, oh, Jekyll to Hyde. You've been dying to tell, you've been timing it right, for just the right person on just the right night. Confessions of a dangerous time. Confessions of a dangerous mind.
Before we get back to this podcast, as a quick reminder, this is a community-supported podcast. Be sure to go to iTunes, leave a rating and review, subscribe to the podcast. Go to WOTSpodcast.com, find the Patreon and PayPal buttons, and leave a donation either monthly or one time. And go to Facebook.com/WordOnTheStreetPodcast. Give the page a like, share it with your friends. All right, before the song, we were going around, we were having beautiful tangential conversations on these three these questions I'm asking. I love it so much. And we're working on, I'm trying to get around to when and your support, who has been your biggest support in your musical making process?
You know, that's hard to say, because everyone who has performed with me, like the band, Ron and the guys, and I'm gonna just make a shout out here of my current lineup of the Trouble Fakers, which includes not just brother Ron Allen here, but Jeff Colchimero on bass, and Donnie Ivan, who has been playing drums with me for a very long time, and our most recent band member, Irene Pena, who is
great solo artist as well,
who is a great soloist in her own right. And when you have all five of us up there, we are a force of nature. We put on a great show, and I have great appreciation of each of these people. They're my friends and my family, and I love them. And I'd say that the biggest source of support has been from the band, because awesome. I'm a free spirit, and my dad is old and cranky, mm-hmm. and you know, I'd say, oh yeah, it's my family, but no, it's not, because they got their own thing going on. Mm-hmm. It's mostly the band itself, mm-hmm. and I get a lot of strength from them. Also, I'd have to say that there are a couple of bookers in the area who have always been nothing but amazing to me.
Oh, awesome.
And have gone out of their way to, say hello or offer me a show. And that list has been short up until recently. So I'm going to also do a shout out to, Stacy Rock Mama Oster.
Okay. Yeah.
She books down in Tacoma, and she books in Renton. A lot of great rock shows come from her, and on the more independent rock side, there's Tim Basaraba, who mm-hmm. has been super nice to me and has just been a great source of support. He's all these people, whenever I go out, and it's hard for me to get out because we were talking about anxiety before we started mm-hmm. to record, my anxiety keeps me in the house.
Mm-hmm.
And I venture out to rehearse. And
I've
to
seen her.
Yeah. Yes, I do.
Yeah, and you're here too.
And to
do podcasts.
Do podcasts.
Yes, awesome.
And to and to buy candy.
Oh, me too.
Yeah. So so these things that I don't get to go out much, and when I do, it's because I've mustered up a lot of strength to go out, and I want to support the people that I've met in the scene,
yeah.
and I've been waiting for shows of yours to come along, and I'm really looking forward to seeing you again. And then there's a bunch of other people in my network that I get to see that play pretty often. I mean, you've got your brands of bands that will play every weekend, or they will play twice a month, or they play once in a blue moon, and I want to see them every time. And,
yeah, awesome.
But when you see me out at a show, you know that there's at least one or two bands on the bill that I really want to see and give them a hug, and I want to hear them play. And I have fought like the devil to get myself in my car to actually go out and do these things. Now, you wouldn't know this by watching me perform.
Yeah.
Because I actually get up there, and I am, my alter ego comes out, and I am just, you know, all hands.
You own it. Yeah.
I do. I'm no Freddie Mercury or anything, but I'm definitely up there to entertain.
Oh,
I'm
totally.
Definitely an entertainer. But for the most part, it's hard for me to see through the anxiety who is actually super supportive.
Mm-hmm.
And I know it's there because I would not still be here doing it.
Mm-hmm.
I would not be writing new music now without their support, without their encouragement. Mm-hmm. So I know it's there. It's just when you have anxiety, generalized anxiety, or a major depressive disorder or episode, those things are really hard to see. But I know that they're there. And if those people are listening, and I know one of them is, thank you, Ron. Fist bump.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
they need to know that I appreciate them, and I want them to succeed as much as I want myself to succeed.
Awesome. No, that's awesome. One thing as we talked earlier and now, you know, I struggle with anxiety myself. Like I just, even last night I was had a major-ish attack, probably not my worst ever, but it was like kept me up. I didn't sleep for like 4 hours last night because I had an anxiety thing going on.
It's tough. It really is.
And it was terrible. One of the things I like to call it as a description to explain to people what it feels like that don't deal with it or don't know, I call it a Dementor attack.
Oh yeah. Yeah, that Harry Potter thing. I think that explains it really well to some people.
Everything goes, it's like that idea, everything goes cool, all the fun is taken out of the world. Kind of, it's like you just, and it's like, it just, it's such an accurate description of what it feels like for me personally anyway.
It's an entity, and it surrounds you, and you don't know how to respond to it. Yeah. All you can do is freeze.
Yeah.
And it takes a lot of strength
mm-hmm.
to just venture away from it, to turn your back on it, and to move and to just separate yourself from it. It's an exercise. Some people, they don't think twice of it, and I envy those people. But I find that strength to turn around because I know that there's something out there that's better than that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's not easy, but I do it, and it's, you have to find your mantra.
Yeah.
You have to find that bit of strength inside of you that goes, you know what, this is worth doing.
Mm-hmm.
There's music out there that our Seattle scene, even though it's struggling with the pay to play and the venues closing down and, you know, the tech sector growing in downtown Seattle. We aren't dead yet. We've got a great scene with a lot of variety in it, and it's worth facing the Dementor.
Yes. Awesome.
You have to face the Dementor. You have to turn your back on it, find that strength, and get that fire going.
Yeah.
I don't know, you can't actually see it on the podcast, but I'm making a face. A face fire. You know, awesome. With the teeth bore. Yeah.
And earlier, way before the song, right when we started the podcast, you mentioned, you did mention like some of your goals and kind of the things that you would like to do. And that's kind of my third question is I try to go to one thing because it's tons.
Direction.
Easily tons of things that you can do. So it's like, and one of the things you mentioned was touring. Is that like a big, like you really, obviously you said it already. You said you really want to get out there and tour.
I do. I don't travel easily.
Yeah.
Because
you're just a complicated one.
I'm very complicated. I'm complicated. I have to have a working toilet and,
what?
That's crazy. Can't go camping. I've never been good at camping.
Oh, okay. Sure.
Camping and touring are different.
That's what they tell me, but you know,
it's not South by Southwest.
We once played with a band out of Montana who basically, there was like five of them. They piled themselves into a truck with a trailer pulling in the back, and they slept in people's yards when they were touring.
Yeah.
And so I thought, well, man, that is dedication.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think I could do that. And the thing keeping me from actually going out and touring now is I want to bring everybody with me. I want everybody to see what we're all capable of.
Yeah.
And I have just not mastered the art of let's get five people into a van or a bus or a
whatever
or a caravan and get them to Portland and Salem and San Francisco or maybe even going out east to Spokane.
Don't forget about our brothers and sisters to the north as well. Yeah.
Well, you have to have some crazy permission to put your instruments across the border.
It's easy peasy, man.
From what I understand, it's the rules have changed recently. So
yeah.
Oh, good.
It's super a lot easy. Easier. Yeah, yeah.
Because I think that would be great. Although I don't enjoy Canadian Shirley Temples. They put orange juice in them.
Okay.
Those are weird. Anyway.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's illegal here in the United States.
It's illegal to put orange juice in Shirley Temples here. But I would love to at least, you know, even if it's just 3 or 4 days.
Yeah.
I have not mastered the art of being able to organize everybody and getting everybody's calendar together.
So it feels like that's the biggest obstacle is the organizational aspect.
It's the organizational aspect of it. That and because the band has done so many awesome things for me. They've provided so much humor and inspiration and talent to the name Wind Sea Blue and all the tracks that go with it. I feel like I'm asking a whole bunch. I'm asking too much. Oh, please give up your life for 5 days and go to another state with me.
You know, I'll do it.
I know Ron will. Ron's awesome. Up for anything. He's like, yeah, you don't even have to pay me. Just put me, strap me to the hood. I'll go.
I'll drive.
Yeah. That's awesome. It's like one of my biggest obstacles back when I was younger. And I wish, you know, learning as you grow, you learn. Right.
Live and learn.
And I'm learning the kind of musician that I want to be more now than I've ever known. And, you know, obviously I wish I knew earlier because I had this idea of touring, like it wasn't worth it unless you're making money and like some like ideas like that. I'm not going to go and waste my time if I'm not, you know, but there's so many other like reasons to go on a tour other than just making money, especially depending on what level of musician you are and all this kind of stuff.
I want to get out there and get to people.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
and I wish I had that mentality, but I also wish I had, I understood. I always thought a tour meant weeks or big.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah.
And it's like you could tour over a weekend. You know,
You can. You can also do a collection of dates around the Puget Sound and call it a tour.
Yeah.
You know? This is our summer tour and catch us, you know.
Yeah.
I would just love to just get on the road and do something like that. But I think one of the things that has thrown me, because I've had a couple of opportunities presented to me, like, hey, we are having a show in Portland. This is one that came up most recently. And I was asked, do you have a draw in Portland?
Yeah.
Which is a strange...
Yes, my draw is 50 in Portland.
Yes, here's a draw. I will pull a napkin out of my pocket and I will draw you a picture and put it in Portland. That is as close as I will get to draw in Portland. Yeah. And, you know, it's a valid question. Do you have fans in Portland? Well, no, because I haven't played out there yet. Yeah. It's the ultimate catch-22 for any band. Do you have draw over here? Do you have draw over there? Well, no, I wouldn't be touring if I had a draw there already. I would probably, you know, just plan to go down there and sing on the street once a year and call it good.
Yeah.
But that, I think that is also a tough one.
Yeah, my so I ran into that sort of... So I've only been on one tour, and it was... bittersweet, I'll say, because it was designed to be the band, but A-Rock hurt his back, so I went solo. Mm. So, but anyways, in that process, it was struggling to fill dates and do all that stuff, and that draw question came up and all that kind of stuff. And what I came to realize is, in the way I'm going to approach it going forward, is go for venues. Like, if you guys have the capability to provide your own show, like bring a PA with you, if that's something that you can do, look for venues that you don't need. You can do that, like coffee shops, other alternate spaces, because they won't ask that question. They'll just be like, yeah or no. You know,
they might as well be asking, is it worth it for us to set up our PA and use our electricity? And
Can we borrow your outlet for a while?
Yeah.
So
that it opens up, it potentially opens up, and this is all theory.
It's a good theory,
but it opens up so much more, because then you get into that city, then you can start networking in that city. You've met the people there, maybe, and then maybe, you know, then with the music biz, you always hope somebody comes that can connect you to something else. Well, you know, and that
a great thing that a lot of artists are doing now, like Mike Dowdy from Soul Coughing, for instance. I follow him on Facebook. He had a lot of success back in the 90s. Mm-hmm. He does house concerts now.
Yeah. Oh,
house
concerts, the living room shows that are going on.
Yeah,
now.
They can be very, very like lucrative in terms of touring. You can reach a lot of fans really fast, mm-hmm. and it's just totally fun going to people's mm-hmm. houses and meeting them.
Yeah,
and, that for us, it's difficult. Five people in a rock
band.
You're not gonna.
That's the limitations of house.
It's
concerts.
More like block party tours versus house concert tours. Yeah. But smaller groups, like if you're just by yourself and you've got your guitar, I mean, that's a perfect thing to do if you can make a few contacts. And there's usually somebody in every town who does house concerts all summer or something like that. You know, and
I would definitely like to, if it means making myself more comfortable with traveling and performing at the same time, I would do a solo or a duo type tour first, you know, just to set a seed in whatever area and get that going on.
Y'all should come back with your whole band.
I got that a lot in 2016. Yeah. Hey, you know, you sound really good. You say you have a band. Well, bring the band with you. And this year has been super interesting. I mean, it started out with Ron's hand healing. And then it went from there to Donnie, our drummer, went on a vacation in Europe for like 2 months, and so we had a whole string of dates there that we needed to either improvise or hire someone to stand in for him, and there were other events there that, because, you know, approaching the end of the school year and then summer, got to do all the stuff with the summer. And so the year got really creative. 2016 was the year that Wincy Blue and her Troublefakers did not perform two single shows with the exact same lineup ever. I think that we did many, I did shows solo.
That Funhouse show, I think, was the last time we had like the full band.
We had the full band playing there.
Yeah, great show.
And then there was Ron and I played some shows, and then Jeff and I played shows together.
And
Irene did a couple of shows together. And then there was shows with Ron and Jeff and myself, and then Ron and Irene and myself.
Yeah.
And I can't remember, have we done an iteration with Irene and Jeff and
I think you have.
Oh, and we even did a show where we didn't have you or Irene, the two other guitar players in the band.
It
so
was
it was
just you and
it was
Jeff
me
and, Donnie.
And Jeff and Donnie, which was weird because I had to be the one not only being the front person, but I also was doing all the guitar stuff, which was extremely scary. But we played for a full hour. I didn't even know I had a full hour of stuff I could play by myself. Yeah. So it was
2016 is the year I bought a cajon.
Yes.
Because I had to be the drummer sometimes.
You had to be the drummer sometimes. it's been a really it helps you grow as a musician to take the music that you already know how to play and then figure out how to play it completely different.
Yeah.
And that I thought I had already grown as a musician because I'd have to write out the lyric sheets and then put notes on that as to, you know, how many measures does the intro go? How many measures is the guitar solo? And then, you know, and hand these out to people to get their stuff together.
You picked up a lot of fans by doing that as well because you got to go to more gigs. And then I think at those kinds of shows, people are more willing to come up and talk to you after the show, and you can connect with the folks.
Well, there's
the
less equipment to try and pick up and move out
you're
too.
Not schlepping stuff around.
But Cubby Casual's songwriter showcase, he will pick out a singer-songwriter, say, "Come on down."
Yeah, yeah.
The Backdoor Trio will be your backing thing. We'll have one rehearsal. We'll go through it, but one of the things you need to do, singer-songwriter, is you need to provide us.
Figure your shit out.
You need to figure your stuff out. We need lead sheets. And so the first time I did that, that was an eye-opening experience. Mm-hmm. But that was only three, maybe four songs.
Yeah.
I had to do that now with at least an hour's worth of work. And I had to do that for two different drummers, Cubby Casual himself, who...
Yep.
Still an amazing booker and drummer in the area. So he's played with us. And then...
I want to say that's the Hattie's Hat.
Hattie's Hat.
Backroom shows. So.
Used to be the pussy room at the Copper Gate, right?
Oh,
before
God bless that place. Yeah.
It was a great room, too.
It was very dark and warm and red. But anyway, it was moist. And I don't know why that place shut down. Maybe it just got old. So he was doing he's doing the Hattie's Hat thing now, and he played with us for a couple of gigs, which was always fun. And we also met Valdemar Hujuet. I always mispronounce it. He's told me three times how to pronounce his last name.
Sure.
His name is Valdemar. He plays drums now for the Salt Riot,
okay,
an up and coming Seattle band. Sweet guy, did a 3-hour show with us in Issaquah. Just really nailed everything.
Yeah, he killed it. Yeah.
He totally killed it. And through this whole process of having to rearrange my band and all of my songs for nearly every single gig this year has really opened my eyes as to what I'm capable of. And also where my limits are.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I'm kind of yearning for some band stability now. And record and do all that stuff.
Yeah,
we
should all get tattoos.
All the five, the five amigos.
Yeah, it's like one of my friends told me one time, I was like, I don't know if I was complaining about a band, but I'm not going to do it justice or say it correctly, but it's essentially the idea of just you basically have to use what you have. And just work, do the best with what you have. And it sounds like you guys have taken that next level almost. It's like,
oh yeah,
you know, it's like if obstacles are in the way, don't complain about what's happening. Just make it different.
Make the best out of it. I've seen bands that are in the scene now that have taken months off while they try to figure out who they need to ramp up and who they need to replace or who needs to do what, and they're off the scene, and you don't necessarily forget about them, but it's always like, oh well, where have you guys been? And then you know, there's the whole, well, how do I put this? Well, so and so had a conniption fit and is now raising chickens, and there was a girlfriend. No, there's in this sense, it was more of a, if I want to keep doing this. And I do.
Yeah.
I need to learn how to improvise. I need to make peace with the songs I like and the songs I don't like. And I need to take those steps. And like any musician, any artist, no matter what you do, there's always going to be a block that you encounter at some point.
And it's normally a voice in your head.
A voice in my head. And for me, I became so stuck on this set of maybe 25 songs that I know how to play that I had forgotten briefly how to write music. And then I had a few things happen at the end of summer that inspired me to write again. So I took November off and told the band, you know what, we're not going to play any shows in November, and we might not play in December, but we're going to just write. We're just going to write a whole bunch of stuff. So we have a handful of new songs that are coming in for 2017.
Awesome.
I am hoping that along with the stuff that inspired the new songs, that I will also get to do some fun stuff in the coming weeks that will inspire more nerd-like songs.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, well, I have on album number two, Good to Drive, there is Four Stars on Expert, which is inspired by Guitar Hero.
Okay.
Sure. Have you ever played Guitar Hero?
I have not, no.
Okay.
I know it, though.
Guitar Hero, in a nutshell, for anyone who doesn't game, is you have your console game and a plastic fake guitar.
Which is nothing like a real guitar.
Nothing like a real guitar. Yeah. Just learn that the like hard way. And you, the little colors scroll down on a screen while music plays, and you are supposed to press buttons and strum the little switch on the fake guitar like you're playing.
Wasn't it like a precursor to Rock Band? Like
it was.
Guitar Hero did come first, and then Rock Band came along and said, oh yeah, fake guitars? Well, we'll raise you. We'll take your fake guitars, and we will raise you fake drums, fake bass, and semi-fake vocals. So... When Rock Band came out, I realized, okay, we're gonna take this, and I wrote Four Stars on Expert to do that.
Not five stars.
Five stars is the most you can get in any game.
Yeah.
But four stars. I think that's an accomplishment.
Four stars is pretty good.
I actually got five stars doing the vocal part on Run to the Hills.
Iron Maiden, yeah. I can't go wrong there.
Mm. I didn't know I could do that, but you know, it's amazing what sort of gobbledygook these games will accept as input. I mean, I was really not singing any English. I was just hitting notes.
Similes.
So, totally. I was doing Simlish the whole way. And aside from Four Stars on Expert, I also wrote a song from the viewpoint of Princess Peach called Castle.
Nice.
We haven't, at this recording, we haven't actually recorded Castle yet, but we have played it all year, and I make sure that I can play it at every show that I do, whether it's with or without the band, I because it's such a crowd pleaser. People are like, what are you talking about? What do you mean jump through the
crowd? That's a good song because it works with the whole band. It works with just one guitar.
It does. It does. It has
this could take the podcast on a whole new level and direction.
Oh, video games and rock and roll.
We gotta be careful here because I'm a classic NES guy. I grew up on that, and that was my
Banjo-Kazooie.
So when I said Princess Peach, you knew exactly who I was talking about.
I did. But Ron, we have to get what are you hoping to accomplish? What is your like one thing that you've been working on or whatever it may be, the thing you think about that maybe keeps you up at night that you're like, oh, music, and if I had this, it would be awesome. What is it? Is there anything? Or
there's not a lot. I'm always trying to learn a new instrument or just get better. I just want to be able to play without thinking so much. And that's something that I just get too cerebral when I'm trying to learn new songs, and I just get a scrunchy concentration face, and I am having fun on the inside, but it doesn't look like it on the outside. Mm-hmm. But I want to be able to relax and just play more.
Oh, I beg to differ. I think it looks like you're having fun when you're actually playing. Not like some people that I have observed on stage that play like they're taking a test.
Exactly, studying for tests. Yeah, if I know the song, totally, I'm like that. I'm learning bass, and I'm also learning mandolin right now as well. And so I've got a set of online lessons that I just always wish that I should just be doing more.
Mm. So learning more is a big goal.
Yeah, I always like to be learning something
awesome.
New.
And you can, and you're doing it. That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So the last question, which is something that you kind of skirted on, like, I don't know, like it was like 10 minutes ago.
Uh-oh.
We were talking about this. What is your impression? Kind of when I say Seattle music scene, what do you think of? And you already let some of it, maybe this wasn't intentional, but you were talking about tech culture coming in, you know, pay to play stuff happening. You'd have to explain to me where you see that happening. But that could be one of the answers. But what is it? What is it for you when you think of the Seattle music scene? What comes to mind? Like,
I think that when I think of the Seattle music scene, I think of a community of like-minded people who all want to add something beautiful to our city. I mean, when you...
And they're blocked at every turn.
Every single turn, like 20-story high rises. Well, no. The it's a challenge now because over the years, I have been given some really bad advice on how to navigate the scene and some really good advice. But most of the stuff has been just observations. I had an opportunity to get away from my day job. And my day job is doing something in technology that is not necessarily anything more than, you know, what you do to get by. Mm-hmm. And I separated myself from the tech world for a full 7 months. And I focused almost completely on making music, on promotion, on learning my craft. And I, all the people that I hung out with were other musicians. I didn't have other techie people saying, oh, well, why don't we go down to the FX McRory's and have ourselves a microbrew? No, I didn't do any of that. I pretty much had maybe $25 in my pocket cash at any given time, and I budgeted my outings on that. I forced myself to introduce myself to people, and I said, took in new bands and old bands, and I realized that there's a lot of people who are very focused on, you know, expressing themselves as artists, as creating new things, and they aren't limited to just making music either. They are in graphic design. They're making posters. They are having art shows. They are combining their shows with dancers. They are putting bills together that you might not think are particularly good combinations until you actually see them. And then you, by doing that, they're spreading the gospel of make music, enjoy music. And these days, I can't watch music television. I can't listen to commercial radio if I don't have some sort of local music in my rotation. It seems kind of, I don't know, maybe it's the casual hipster in me that just doesn't want to listen to the mainstream stuff anymore. All that stuff is engineered to get you and your teenagers to listen to it and have sex and do their crazy things. But with the local stuff, you're getting, your friends are singing to you. Your community is singing to you. It's a reflection of what's going on in town. And I just want to... I want to be a part of that.
Oh, yeah. Didn't a while back you wore like a different band shirt every day?
Yeah, the Wear It Wednesday thing.
Wear It Wednesday, that's what it was.
Wear It Wednesday.
Still, it's still going on, sort of. There's like, I don't know, for me, I've kind of dropped off a little bit just because I've ran out of t-shirts. And
yeah, there's, for a while there, I only had like maybe three t-shirts. And one of them was the Zim and A-Rock. And so I would promote that, put it on the Instagram. There was the Pat Galactic shirt that I wore. Wyatt Olney had a really cool bright green and black t-shirt that I wore. And now I have a C-Star t-shirt because Ron's other band is C-Star. And recently I added Tobias the Owl t-shirt, which I didn't realize until I got it home is actually navy and not black.
Didn't Jim Marcotte have a shirt as well? Did you pick one of those
I did not pick up a Jim Marcotte in the Breakthrough shirt. And I'm still trying to figure out how do I make a Win C. Blue and her Trouble Fakers t-shirt without...
I have one.
Well, yeah, I made that one.
I have a one-off.
I made that one with a freezer paper stencil and some spray fabric paint, which is great. But the big thing about the scene is it's community, and we are all striving for the same thing. We need to all be making and creating. We can't just be a bunch of tech people in t-shirts and expensive tennis shoes sitting around going, I wonder what this drink tastes like. You know, no, it's, you have to go out and you have to absorb the energy from all of these live shows. And it breaks my heart when I hear of a venue that seems to be doing really well, they just shut their doors. It breaks my heart because usually, and this is the saddest thing to me, is that it's usually the venues that are actually paying.
The place over in Woodinville, what was that place called?
Big Daddy's.
Big Daddy's. Great stage, awesome sound guy, huge, big crowds, and then boom, suddenly it's gone.
Yeah, their big problem is that if you have a venue that supports music, you want to have music in there every night, right? But they were only getting people to come in on the weekends. Through the week, they were losing money. And so that didn't balance out. I remember talking to the guy who owned Big Daddy's. He's like, I just can't keep it up. Mm. You know, at this rate, I'm only going to be open a couple of days a week, and that's no way to run a business.
Yeah.
But what I would say to anybody who wants to hear more about the Seattle scene is get out there. Mm-hmm. And support it. Mm-hmm. Look in The Stranger or The Weekly, or, you know, see if you have any musicians in your circle of friends and they have a bunch of likes on their Facebook page. Find out who they're following and, you know, say, hey, are you going to any shows? Yeah, I'm going to this show. And it's always easier to go to a show if you have somebody to go with you. Mm-hmm. That's something that I need to employ more often, but because most of my friends are older and they have kids. They can't really separate themselves, but I try to get out there anyway.
Yeah.
My technique is I always, whenever I see an event that looks like it might be something I want to see, I hit interested on the Facebook event. And later on, as I'm solidifying my calendar, I'll change that to going. Mm-hmm. And whenever I do that, other people on my Facebook feed that are following me, mm-hmm. they see that I've interacted with the event, and then they get to, you know, be aware of it too. Mm-hmm. And I try to promote other people's shows as much as I can. And for a couple of weeks earlier this month, I was promoting some other people's shows that, you know, people I believed in that I thought, you know, you guys have to see these people. Mm. And so I did that. And so we all have to support each other. We all have to realize that if we don't come together and support each other, mm-hmm. which is unlikely because every single person in the Seattle music scene that I've encountered has been extremely positive and supportive. Mm. And, you know, I've never had so many hugs as I've had this year going out to shows and encountering people and, oh, I'm so glad you came to my show. Here, let me give you a hug. It's so good to see you. And yeah. you know, just loving, wonderful, creative, yeah. high creative people that all want this aspect of our lives and culture to still be relevant. Mm-hmm. I would hate to see Seattle go from being the birthplace of grunge to, oh, it's that city with all of the flash cube buildings and people yeah. with no social skills.
Sure.
No, we don't want to do that. We want to be a balanced mix of those people.
Yeah. You know what's cool, though? In Seattle, you can still play on a few stages where Soundgarden played back in the day. You know what I mean? They still exist. Like, we played at the Central, right?
We played at the Central.
That's a famous stage. And you still can see it. There's still a few of those old venues around
back in the day. Well, Ron, for you, what comes to mind when you hear Seattle music scene, Northwest music scene?
I'm totally not as connected with the scene as Wynn is, because I'm an introvert when it comes to stuff like that. I rarely introduce myself to people, and I kind of just meet people through other people.
Yeah.
But I'm part of two scenes. We're in the rock band, you know, the pop and the funk, and then I'm also in a Celtic band, which is a completely different scene.
Yeah.
And never the two shall meet, except for the rare player who's in two bands.
Yeah.
And so there's that scene, and it's very laid back. Like, you end up playing in churches. Mm-hmm. There's always a lot of people there. You can get more paying gigs because you're a bigger fish in a smaller pond kind of thing.
Yeah.
Like, there aren't a lot of bands around Seattle that are competing for the Celtic crowd, right? Yeah. And so it makes it easier to get better shows in a lot of cases.
And the acoustic scene in this town is very active.
That's right.
It's a good entry point
if you want to see
more live music.
And there's, for instance, they have a community and they'll do like the working musicians office party because mm-hmm. they're working musicians and everybody else gets an office party. So why shouldn't they? So they pick a venue and everybody goes there and they have their own office party. Mm-hmm. Like, they all work together as working musicians in Seattle, which is pretty cool. So I think of that scene as being definitely older as far as, you know, age groups go. Everybody knows absolutely everybody, and if you piss somebody off, you'll never play at their show again or their friend shows again or whatever.
I think that's pretty much true with any tier.
I guess it is, but
scene.
But if you hit a weird vein, like last year or 2 years ago, we hit this weird maritime vein. We had like one song that mentioned a boat or something, and all of a sudden we were playing the maritime circuit all around the Puget Sound. Like we got on some kind of weird train and we played all these shows and they were really fun. And, you know, it was like usually outdoors and there were a lot of people there and you get a lot of exposure. And then now all of a sudden, there's like none of that. We didn't actually piss anybody off, but then you play weird ass shows because it's just people that you know. If you're in a band with people who are doing other forms of art, like filmmaking or, you know, recording, field recording or production and stuff like that, then you get hooked up with another event. And my other band is this cat named Michael Falcone, and he's totally hooked up with the Fremont Arts Council. So we get weird shows. Like we played the Winter Solstice event for the Fremont Art Council last year, which is the weirdest gig ever.
It's the Yule show, right?
It's
lots of pagans.
It's crazy. It's just the whole scene is just bizarre, right?
One person's weird is another person's normal.
Yes, exactly.
And everyone's wearing costumes. It's pretty cool. It's super fun, but it is nothing like I've ever played.
It's
before.
Another
you
world.
Feel
it
almost
really
guilty while you're there. I don't know why. I don't know. What's the weirdest venue you've played at around here?
Ooh, well, the weirdest venue I've played around here. I can't think of any real weird venues.
I'm trying to think of it too, but
I'm trying to, because it's all been,
what would you define as weird?
Like, I don't know. You just go there and you're like, should we be playing here? Or this is the smallest stage ever. Are you sure a band has ever played on this stage?
You know, if you're going to put it like that, I'd have to say, and this is not.
Or the Williams Avenue pub when the guy was just like right in your face and, you know, like a weird experience.
Oh, well, he was. He had been drinking.
He meant well.
But I think the strangest place that I've played, as far as Ron's criteria goes, had to be Tim's Tavern. And Tim's Tavern is you know, it's been in Seattle for 100 years. Their default picture on their website is when the building was first built. It's just been there forever, and I don't know how long they've been doing live music, but the stage is, you know, you make the most of the space that you have. They've got the curtains up there, and they've got lights, and their soundboard is a decent, but it's so small, and they frequently have full bands in there. And I remember seeing one band that I was like, oh, this band's really good. But the guy had their drum kit on the stage along with like their bassist and maybe their guitarist. And then the singer was pretty much dancing out amongst the tables in the bar because there was no place else to go. And when we played there last.
Yes, the Angry Show.
The Angry Show. I'm not even going to think about why I was angry at the point. It had nothing to do with the venue. It had something to do with, when you're with other bands on a bill, you'd be nice to the other bands on the bill. Okay. We won't go
Seattle there. Scene.
Yeah, yeah, Seattle scene. That's the only time I have ever been unhappy with the scene. And these guys, they were posers. Anyway, but I remember playing the show and there was no room for all four of us up there. And Donnie had his kit. He's got this glorious kit that sounds awesome. And in order for me to perform, I couldn't actually be on the stage. I had to be in front of the stage. Plus, I was in heels, and they were new heels, and I had balance issues, and, you know, all these.
It was a good show.
It was a good
Everybody
show.
Liked it.
We had a blast. And between that tiny stage and the strange corner-shaped stage of Soul Food Books in Redmond.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember we set up the whole band on the Soul Food bookstore stage.
Yep.
And having the points of my heels just being right on the edge of the stage and thinking, I probably shouldn't dance very much.
I recorded a whole album there.
Which is,
yeah.
Well, you probably weren't doing it in 3-inch heels either.
No, I wasn't.
Yes,
no,
thank goodness for that. That might have been awkward.
Cool. Well, this last, like, you know, that last question of just the Seattle scene, what is it? What comes to mind? And obviously, for me personally, we could have taken what you guys talked about in the last 5-7 minutes here and expounded into an entire hour conversation.
Exactly.
Dissecting all the things, because you brought up a lot of things that are, you know, interesting to talk about for me personally.
Probably like, common across a lot of different people as well, because you talk to a lot of folks.
Yeah. Well,
right?
This is really this is the first time I've really asked the question. That's my new question, just to ask it blatantly like that.
It's a good question.
We usually get it sprinkled in through the conversation, but I'm trying to find out, because this is the goal from the beginning of this podcast has been that this part of the conference, this is the goal for me, has always been, what does it mean to be a part of the Seattle music scene? It's really been the goal. But it's like, I could never really figure out how to get that question out the right way.
So then you just decided to ask it?
Yeah, well, just decided to ask it, but notice it was the fourth of three questions.
Yeah.
So we were primed.
We were getting there.
We were getting there, which it was awesome. So basically, it's just like there's a lot more there that we can dig around on and stuff. And just thank you for sharing,
absolutely
sharing your experience and doing that.
It's been I'll tell fun. You what, it's a fun place to play music.
It is a fun place to play, and I see a lot of overlap in just not just the music scene and the genres and stuff, but I have been introduced to a number of visual artists as well. The substation has gone through a number of modifications over the last year. It went from, okay, you go in and there's a door off to the right and there's this big room with a stage in it. Oh, that's great. To, oh, you go in and there's the door to the stage room, but there's this hallway where they put photographs or paintings or whatever. Yeah. And now it's, you go in, door to the stage room, paintings, and now there are booths that you can hang out in. And I remember the first time I went in and I saw some artwork that really spoke to me. Mm-hmm. And then that guy ended up showing up at another event at the Skylark to paint on site while the music was playing. Oh, cool. Yeah. And so I've encountered a lot of visual artists as well. And
aside from their precarious steps, I think the Skylark is one of my favorite places to play here.
I do enjoy the Skylark. Like ever since they got rid of that humongous piano in that one corner of the stage,
so
and
good,
now there's actually room to perform. So their new management and the developments they've made over the last few years has been really amazing.
Awesome.
But there's a lot of overlap in the creative communities in the Seattle music scene. Mm-hmm. So if you know a musician, you probably also know a visual artist.
Well, and that's, you know, we're basically done. So we've sprinkled in how you, Wynn, are a visual artist as well and stuff. So even, you know, obviously in the scene, musicians do more than one thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's how part of how those connections happen. But this four questions carried us through the whole conversation.
It did.
So we did it.
No awkward silence.
It was awesome. You guys were amazing. This is a great.
Well,
great
I hope you have a mess of cool stuff to edit in. If you use all of it, or just
we use all of it.
Pieces.
It's all there.
Oh my god.
Yeah, we don't edit here on Word on the
okay,
Street.
Well, I'm glad I didn't burp.
Okay. well, that would have been excellent to have been there. but we have to wrap it up with a song. So you have to tell me what song you want to put in to close it out.
You know, Ron and I had a list of stuff, and I was thinking, oh, just two songs. Oh, no, maybe three songs. But I think that since I touched upon my nerd streak, I'm going to make this next song 4 stars on Expert.
Okay, yeah, great.
Good choice.
It's off of our second album, Good to Drive.
Okay.
And it is my love song tribute to Guitar Hero / Rock Band.
Awesome. So before we drop the song in, is there anything that we didn't say during this conversation that you did want to bring up or say?
Well, let me look at my list. No, I have a little 6x4 card here. No, I think I covered everything.
Let's drop some social network handles or websites or whatever again, just to...
You can find us on Facebook, facebook.com/TroubleFakersHQ. I'm on Instagram as WynnCBlue. And I also am just learning Twitter, so you can find me on Twitter as WynnC.
Yeah. Wynn spelled W-Y-N-N-E.
Yes, don't forget the E or you're going to end up someplace that's not me. I also have a Bandcamp, and Bandcamp is, you'll see some of my illustrations on Bandcamp, WynnCBlue.bandcamp.com. So if you want to see some cool cats and illustrations and maybe a few 30-second
videos. Don't
forget
about your Etsy store. I mean, come on.
No, the Etsy store, I'm going to retool it.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to retool it. But I used to do sculptures as well.
Okay, good.
But now I think I'm going to do pen and ink.
We have some stuff on SoundCloud as well.
Yeah, we do. SoundCloud Preset 1 on SoundCloud is where a majority of Ron's music for the RPM Challenge is.
PRESET and the number 1.
Okay, great. Well, great. Thank you, Wynn and Ron. This was excellent.
Thanks, Zim. We had a lot of fun.
So good. So we'll close it out with 4 stars on Expert, good off the Good to Drive album.
Yes.
By WynnCBlue and the Trouble Fakers.
Fakers.
And remember to always party at the Moon Tower.
Thanks so much for joining us once again. We made it to the end of another version of Word on the Street. And like I said at the top, I got more things to talk about, yo. And of course, I have to remind you to donate, to subscribe, to support this community we're building, you and me together. Seattle music scene, Northwest music scene. This is the only podcast dedicated exclusively to more of what's going on around the scene. We're not just picking and choosing. We're trying to get to know everybody. We're trying to get to know every part of the scene. Hip-hop, you know, grunge, rock, you know, jazz, you know, everything. As long as it's original, as long as it's awesome, as long as it's just real, that's what I'm talking about. We're getting to know all of it. So let's do it together. I need your help to make that happen. Go to iTunes, leave a rating and review, subscribe to it. Go to Patreon, leave a donation, monthly donation, $1 or more. Go to facebook.com/worldonthestreetpodcast. Give the page a like. Let's get to that 1,000 mark like and beyond. Let's get to 10,000. Let's get to 100,000 likes on the podcast. That'd be sweet. Hey, I want to remind you right now as well, remind you or tell you for the first time maybe, I'm going back to Seattle. I'll be in Seattle March 16th through the 24th. The objective is to record a bunch of podcasts, see some people, do some other side work as well, just do a bunch of stuff. And also, I booked a show. So my birthday, my actual physical birthday is on March 14th. I'll be 40 years old this year. Awesome. Made it 40 years. Yeah, that's right, yo. And I put a show together. It's going to be my 40th birthday celebration. I just got, just hours before recording this outro here, I got the confirmation for the final band that's going to be on the lineup. We're going to play the High Dive. The Zim and A-Rock's going to open up. This is March 19th. Did I mention that? I don't know. March 19th, Sunday. The Zim and A-Rock's going to open up. We got Among Authors, who's been on the podcast. They're awesome. They're super rad friends of mine. Got to check them out. One of my favorite Seattle bands. They're going to play second. And then we got Honor Hall, which the Zim and A-Rock have played with before at the Jet in when it was open in Mill Creek. So it's all in the family. We're making this happen, and I'm super stoked to celebrate my 40th birthday. So I need you to be there. It's gonna be off the hizzy. That's what I said, hizzy. And we'll do this. So make sure you're there March 19th, the High Dive. The show is gonna start early, 7:30. We're taking the stage, 7:30, and then so you can get to bed early, because the whole show will end by like 10 o'clock or something. 10:30, 11 maybe at the latest. So there's that. A couple other things I need to mention, I want to mention. So I'm in the process right now of making We're on the Street an actual legitimate business, along with everything else I do that you've heard me talk about, the Alexander Thomas Clutch, the Zimmen A-Rock, you know, lots of other things. I'm learning all about how to make a business, getting my business license, getting what they call a fictitious business name, and getting, you know, a bank account that's for my business, and DBAs, doing business as stuff, and learning all about this stuff, and seller tax things, and whatever, just all this crazy stuff. So as a part of that whole process, word on the street is becoming a business. And the reason I bring that up is just because, well, A, I just want to let you know what's going on with it. The umbrella company, the big company that everything that's going to live under, is called Orange Peel Collective. And I've, a long time ago, if you know anything about the Zim and A-Rock or my music, the Zim myself, I wrote a song called Orange Peel. I'm not sure, it's recorded somewhere. It hasn't been recorded well anywhere, but, and I just got attached to that name. So I decided to, I've been calling kind of this idea of my business Orange Peel Productions for a really long time, and there's already an Orange Peel Productions out there, so I decided to just call it Orange Peel Collective because I'm doing multiple things under this one umbrella: the podcast, my clutch, my, you know, my music, and anything else I can think of as time evolves. So it'll be all be under this one thing, and it'll all funnel through one idea. We're on the street, obviously, as part of that. So what that means, so I know that sounds a little bit like, oh, he's making a business, does that mean he's making money? No, I'm not making any money off of World on the Street, but I wanted to make sure I'm ready so that when you basically start to pay for this, you decide that it's important to you to keep this thing going, there's a legitimate pathway for you to make that happen. And when I use the money that you've contributed to it, I can write it off. I can do the whole tax thing. I can make your money go farther by saying, this was an expense. I bought a new microphone. I'm paying for server space. I'm, you know, whatever it may be. There's a gazillion different things. I'm advertising for the podcast. I'm just doing a whole bunch of stuff to make your money go farther so that, you know, it can just grow this whole thing so that your investment in World on the Street podcast will go even farther. So I'm making it a business. I'm learning all about it. So I just wanted to let you know what's going on. I'm making a business out of World on the Street. So I'm pretty stoked on it. I don't know. Can you tell? It's pretty fun. It's fun learning. It's kind of crazy how, you know, figuring it all out, but it's fun learning and I'm feeling good about it. And my goal, I just want to be upfront with you as well. My goal, my immediate goal for the podcast, I want to make $1,000 off the podcast a month. So you are the ones that can help create that. If you're interested in helping create that, that would be amazing if I could make $1,000 a month off the podcast. It would alleviate a lot of pressure to have to do other things, and I would be able to devote way more time to the podcast. I could get closer to this idea of publishing more often. I'd be able to do way more video aspect of the podcast. I'd be able to explore different ideas. I'd be able to travel more with the podcast. There'd be so much more I could do if I was able to make $1,000 a month to start with the podcast. So where are we at right now? We are at 89 cents a month is what I'm making on the podcast, in a sense. I mean, I'm not even making that, you know, because I'm paying way more for this podcast out of my pocket, essentially, than I'm making. Right now, we have a Patreon donor. It's a $1 donation. What I make off that $1 is 89 cents. Patreon takes 11 cents. So there's that. And that's fine. I'm okay with that. There's a lot of people that says, I'd rather just pay you directly. Patreon makes it easy. And then I can write off that amount. You know, that's a service. They're providing a service to make it easy so that you can support the podcast and I can write off that amount. So don't worry about that. I would love it if you went and became a Patreon donor because it would show the rest of the world that, hey, people want to be a part of this. People want this to grow and thrive. People want the Northwest music scene to grow and thrive and want to learn more about it. You would help create that. The more internet viralness, you know, interaction we can do together, the better. So we're doing these transactions behind the scenes, it helps, but I like the idea of showing the world that we want this to happen. So consider that. I hope you will. go to WOTSpodcast.com, find that Patreon button, click it, and leave a donation. Help me achieve this. Help me get toward that $1,000 a month mark so I can do more with this podcast. Thanks a lot for that. I want to remind you as well, every week I do a video journal on YouTube. If you're a YouTube guy or girl or person want to and spend time on YouTube and like to watch videos, check out my channel. It's youtube.com/thezimvideo. I do a video journal every week. I'm up to 142 or something like that videos of the video journal. And it's fun. I go into more details about what the podcast was all about for me in the last week. I describe what's going on in the world of the music, the Zim and A-Rock, just at the Alexander Thomas Clutch, Tunnel Books. I make Tunnel Books. There's another thing I do. Just what's going on in life, like my transition to San Diego and living in San Diego. I talk about that. So it's kind of a fun. I usually limit it to about 20 minutes or less. So just as kind of, it's kind of this little show about what's going on in the world of the Zim. And I'd love it if you checked it out. And I'd also love it if you subscribe to that channel to help me grow those subscription numbers over there. All that great stuff. And then, of course, Alexander Thomas, like I mentioned a couple times, that's a handbag I make. You can find it, Alexander Thomas 2015, on Etsy and on Instagram are the two places it lives right now. I have a few of them. I have like four of them on Etsy right now because I'm still working on building up inventory and getting materials I need to make more of them and things like that. So if you want to support the podcast and other things and this whole thing I'm creating, buying one of those would be awesome. It's a great handmade gift. I do it all myself. Buy them for yourself or for a friend, and there'll be more to come, so keep an eye on that. So that'd be great. Thanks a lot for joining me again for another podcast, and I'll catch you next week. Every week we put one out, every week so far I've been able to keep it on, so let's keep doing this. That's another thing, talking about that $1,000 donation, getting to that $1,000 point will guarantee that this comes out every week. There's a potential, because I'm now in San Diego trying to make sure I coordinate and get everything done and get as many interviews as I need. There is a potential that I may miss a week here or there because it's just logistically different. I'm not in Seattle like I used to be. So consider that. If you want to see this thing keep going, I need those monetary donations. I need some money to be flowing through this, and you can make that happen. And it doesn't all have to be about you spending your money, but if you are passionate about this and want to share it, you could share it out. You could tell people about it and get someone else to donate the money. That'd be excellent too. So don't think I'm guilting you into, if you don't donate money, I don't appreciate you, because I do. I appreciate everybody that's listening to this. If you made it this far, if you're listening all the way to the end of this podcast, you are amazing. I love you for that. So thanks a lot. Catch me next week. I'll catch you next week. Let's do this together. All right. We're on the street. Peace.